and so many universities. Our next speaker is going to present from a different angle. She is our very own senior reporter of the Chronicle of Higher Education, Karen Fisher. You probably know her name very well because she writes reports of international agencies, international students, and many others. So she covers the business of international education and the globalization of higher education, including competition for foreign students, activities by American colleges overseas, policies and programs that affect the international activities of American colleges, and the internationalization of the college experience. Karen joined the Chronicle in 2005, a decade ago, to write about U.S. higher education politics and policy. She previously worked for Kiplinger Washington Editors, Media News Group's Washington Bureau, the Charleston, West Virginia Daily Mail, and the Daily Hemisphere, Massachusetts. Her work has also appeared in the New York Times, Washington Monthly, and George Magazine. In 2010, Karen was one of the 10 reporters selected to be selected for the East-West Center's Jefferson Fellowship Program for study and reporting in Asia. She also is a recipient of the Paul Miller Washington Reporting Fellowship and a National Press Foundation Fellowship on the Business of Higher Education. She is part of the reporting teams that have been honored with the UTNE Independent Press Awards, Award for Best Political Coverage, and by the Education Writers Association for the articles Asia Rising / American Falling, and the Towns, Gowns, and Taxes series. A graduate of Smith College, she also was a recipient of the Poynter Institute News Reporting and a Writing Fellowship for college graduates, which recognizes a dozen outstanding young journalists annually. Ladies and gentlemen, let's welcome Karen Fisher.
As Jun said, I'm an international reporter at the Chronicle, but I sometimes joke that I'm the Chinese student reporter because I came on this beat about 9 years ago. And that really was, the timing, I didn't realize it then, but the timing was really auspicious because my experience covering international issues really very much dovetails with and matches up with the explosion of Chinese students on American college campuses. A decade ago, we had only about 68,000 Chinese students. Most of them were graduate students, more than two-thirds. China wasn't even our largest source of international students. At that point, it was still India. As Darla said, now one in every three students is from China, or one in three international students is from China. Sometimes it gets like one in every three on certain campuses, but so I say this because, aside from making myself feel old, I just feel like I've seen kind of the life cycle of students. There are students who I started covering when they were freshmen, who have now graduated, and I've seen them go back to China and looked at sort of how this whole process has worked. I know that the title of this conference, this forum, is Beyond Recruitment, but I'm going to start by talking about recruitment. One of the things that June asked me to talk about is sort of what this phenomenon has really meant both for the students and for the colleges and the ways that it has and has not worked for both of them. And I think when we're talking about the challenges in Darla, outlined many of them that we see for Chinese students, it really begins with the recruitment process. As I mentioned before, when this whole sort of wave of Chinese students started to come to American campuses, up till that point, most of our Chinese students have been at the graduate level. And thus, that was really the way that recruitment happened. You know, there would be faculty members who had, you know, faculty colleagues in at Chinese universities, you know, in physics or in chemistry, in engineering, and they would send their best students here to be graduate students. There's almost like a pipeline. The number of colleges, like my own, I do mention I went to Smith. You did see, I mean, eons ago when I was in college, there were, we did have a fairly large percentage of our population, our student body, who was international. We had one mainland Chinese student in my class. But those colleges were also had a very specific pipeline that they were recruiting to, because these were very, very elite students typically, and so they were going to very specific schools. Oftentimes, these students weren't even studying in their home countries. They were studying elsewhere in international schools and programs. And so I didn't fully appreciate this when I came on the beat, but it became very, very clear because, as Darla and Jim both suggested, I think a lot of the conversation for a while really was so focused on recruitment. And that was because both sides really were feeling their way. Not only did the colleges really not know where to go and recruit undergraduate students, and while Sally pointed out, we're now 50-50 in terms of our Chinese student population, really the massive amount of growth has come at the undergraduate level. So our colleges really didn't know where they should go, where they should find the students, how they should evaluate them, who was the best fit. And the Chinese students were really very unprepared as we sort of had this more massification of the market. They were really unprepared for what it takes to apply to an American university. And that's simply because of the way that the Chinese system works. You take the Gaokao, the Chinese college entrance exam, how you do on it depends not only if you go to college, it determines where you go, it determines often what you study. And so the students and their families were really coming to the American college admissions process in somewhat of the same way. And so it's understandable then that they would think of the TOEFL or the SAT as kind of an all or nothing thing. And it really raised the stakes, and it really kind of determined a little bit how those students were preparing for those exams. And so you had a rise of these cram schools, which we've seen in other countries like Korea. You know, the students sort of, you know, spending all their time memorizing vocabulary words to succeed on the TOEFL. Well, that's great, but it didn't really serve American colleges very well, because really, when they looked at those TOEFL scores, they weren't really seeing, oh, this is how well the students were to do in an American college classroom. Really, what it was saying is, this is how well a student can study for an English exam. And you know what you saw, I mean, which also makes, I think, in some ways, a lot of sense, is, as Darla said, the commercialization of the admissions process. I think we talk a lot about agents in this country. A lot of the debate has been around American colleges hiring them, but what was really happening in China was Chinese families were hiring people to help guide them through the admissions process. Some of these people are very, very good and really kind of did a service to the students, and some of them were not ethically very, did not do ethically very appropriate things. So they were doing, you know, things like forging transcripts and writing students' essays. And so when American colleges, and I think this is less of a key problem now than it had been before, but for a time when American colleges were getting these students on campus, they really didn't know who they were getting. So who showed up wasn't necessarily what was reflected in the application in their admissions decisions. And this matters, of course, because it, you know, affects the things that Darla was talking about in the college classroom. I do think, in the same way that American colleges had this sort of graduate student pipeline now, in the sort of previous generation, I think you see more of a more established pipeline now, where, you know, you have American colleges having more established relationships with high schools. We've also seen a huge explosion in the Chinese secondary education system of high schools that specifically prepare students to come and study in the United States or in Canada or in Britain or Australia. So the colleges know more where to go. They have a better sense of ways to evaluate the students. They're sending more people overseas to recruit the students. And the students themselves are savvier. I mean, I was in China last year and to do a story specifically on recruitment, and I had a lot of students really take great pride in telling me, I did not hire anybody to help me. I have made it this admission, this application, it's on me. That said, what we see though is sort of more of a bifurcation of the market. And so you have a whole host of colleges that have been doing this now for 10 years or more. They're getting a lot savvier. You have a whole group of students in Shanghai and Beijing and Shenzhen and Guangzhou who are also more familiar with the process, who have classmates and friends who made it through and gone to study in America. But then we're seeing the rise in China of second and third tier cities. Cities that aren't as westernized and don't have some of the same programs are a little bit off the beaten trail for American colleges. They're getting in the mix, they're sending their students. And we're seeing a lot more colleges send, or want to recruit rather, students from overseas. Maybe it's because they have realized the importance of diversity and the importance of having international students on their campus. Maybe it's because they need to make their budgets work. I think it's a little bit of both probably. But you have colleges that never had recruited international students, not even on the graduate level, suddenly showing up in China and not knowing where to go. And so that's just to say that I think the recruitment puzzle has become a little less acute, that problem, but it still exists, and it's kind of, you know, like fresh players in the field having challenges. So that's the first piece of the life cycle of the Chinese student, right? Getting them here. Then they're on your campus. I know Darla talked a bit about the classroom. I know Jun and Agnes also are going to talk more about that, so I won't spend a lot of time on it, except to say this. I think it's really a double-edged sword. One thing I think that's been great is for faculty members, because of the numbers of Chinese students in their classrooms and international students in general, I think there has been a growing awareness of the particular issues that these students may face. And so a decade ago, it might be easy for a faculty member just to think that this student just was stupid and not getting the material. And I think now when I talk to faculty members, they have a much greater appreciation of the different learning styles, that they're coming from a lecture-centered classroom, a teacher-centered classroom, that they may not be familiar with working groups or critical thinking, and doing some of the things that Darla suggested to try to address that. On the other hand, I think it also can lead to generalizing, to just say, oh, well, the Chinese students, they plagiarize, or they don't work well in groups, they don't speak up. And so I think it works both ways. But I want to spend a little bit more time talking about what happens outside of the classroom, because quite honestly, although professors, faculty members certainly are, as individuals, spend a lot of time with Chinese students, most students' time is actually spent outside of the classroom. And I would argue that the problems are perhaps even a little bit more hard to manage there. Because although I have heard an occasional faculty member grumble to me, well, you know, they came to study here in America, so they should follow my rules, and I'm not going to change anything I do to accommodate my Chinese students. You know, I think most faculty members, rather, are well-intentioned. They really want to do the things that will help their Chinese students, all their students, succeed in the classroom. The challenge outside of the classroom is there isn't any one group who's responsible for international students and who is intervening. As Darla pointed out, the international office, because it's got international in its name, sometimes can sort of be assumed to be dealing well with all these things. But it's not necessarily the case. And I'll talk in a minute about the different sort of players and partners in this, but let me just tell you about sort of the average Chinese student who is on our campuses today. When she arrives here, she probably arrives at a large research university, because we know that even our undergraduates from China tend to gravitate towards research universities. You know, they have brand ID they do well in the rankings, they're familiar to brand-conscious Chinese families. She probably is coming a week, 2 weeks, maybe more, before classes start, because she's going to go through international admissions, or international orientation. I think that we see a lot of universities invest in international orientations, and there's many ways in which these are great things. You know, not only is it a time for colleges to do all the paperwork and the visa processing that they have to do with international students, but it gives the students time to acclimate to college, to get over their jet lag, and you know, and it gives the colleges time to give sort of programming that is more specific to an international audience, to talk about things like plagiarism, to talk about what's expected in an American classroom, for example. The challenge of this is, if you think about it, it's a week or two before any Americans show up. And it's a critical time for these students. They make their friends, they form their peer networks, they are navigating things and the first challenges and problems they have, you know, where do I go to buy sheets? How do I get a cell phone that's going to work in the United States? And the people that they are with, who they are turning to, who become their support network, and often their friends, their best and closest friends, they all look like them. And many campuses, not only are they all international, but most of them are Chinese. And so by the time the Americans even show up on campus, they already have these bonds. So this is a really, really big hurdle to overcome. You know, colleges are trying to do something really good for the students, to accommodate them, to help them acculturate, and it ends up having this other effect. I think somebody mentioned English language institutes. You know, as I said, sometimes we are having students come to this country and they need a little extra help to sort of be able to succeed and to speak in a work in a college classroom. I mean, any of us who have tried to be in a college classroom in a different language knows that it's one thing, like I can carry on a great conversation with you in French, but when I went to study in Paris as an undergraduate, you know, suddenly I had to talk about great literature in French. It was, and science, it was, you know, technical terms, it was really difficult. And so the ELIs, English Language Institutes, provide a really helpful service. Well, what do they also do? They also provide a place where you're separate from the rest of the student body. And if you go to an English language classroom today at most of our campuses, you'll see Chinese students, Brazilian students, Saudis, and honestly, the Brazilians and the Saudis aren't coming in as large numbers, so they're very, very Chinese. And so it's, again, a time where, you know, we're really trying to help the students, but it's also reinforcing some of the social challenges that they have on campus. Then there's housing. Darla had a Chinese roommate. That is very unusual. There are a handful of colleges that have been very interventionist, who have required their international students to have American roommates. It is not necessary. I think a lot of colleges have not done that. They've been leery of, they would like to encourage it, but they let the students make their own choices. And what really tends to happen is that, you know, you have your American student at a large state university who wants to room with their friend from high school. And the Chinese student says, well, maybe I'll have my friend from high school here, but I want to be living with somebody who understands me, who gets where I come from, and you know, who really can be a support system for me. And many of the Chinese students that I saw over the years who have had American roommates, by the end of the first semester, they were squatting in their friend's dorm room. They, you know, came in with the best of intentions, and then there's no support network within the sort of housing system to sort of make those relationships necessarily work well. When I first would go to campuses, I started to notice that I would go to campuses and there would be entire floors, sometimes entire residence halls that were all Chinese or all international. And sometimes this was happening, you know, sort of initially because you know, the Americans, the domestic students, they'd come to campus, they would know sort of, oh, this is the cool dorm to live in, this one near the fraternity row, and so we can go to parties or something. And like, I would go just to campus after campus and go to visit Chinese students and have to like hike, you know, halfway across campus because they were getting the less desirable places to live because they were kind of coming late to the sort of housing lottery. Now I've actually seen this get reinforced because now, yeah, sure, that dorm is far out, but it's the Chinese student there. And if you're living there as a Chinese student, you're comfortable. And then, again, this is totally well-meaning, the food services says, the Chinese students, they feel homesick because they don't like the food, so we're going to improve the quality of food. Well, where do most of our Chinese students live? Well, they live in this dorm. Well, why don't we improve the food there? And the Chinese students are like, well, this is the only place that I want to eat the food, so I'm going to live in this residence hall. And so it's all these things that colleges do with good intent, the best of intent, but increase these kind of social issues. There was a study a couple of years back that looked at international students, not specifically the Chinese students, and we asked the students if they had any American friends. And the majority of the students did not. And I'm afraid, that if we did that study today, it would not be changed. What has changed is the Chinese students know it. Four or five years ago, I did a story at some of the year going to a college campus, hanging out with Chinese students going through their freshman year to kind of experience it with them. And I had this one really incredibly kind of compelling student who, thing he wanted most was to have an American friend. And it was probably 6 or 8 months into me going and hanging out with him for a week at a time. And he looked at me, he's like, Karen, you're my one American friend. My heart broke because I'm a reporter. And also I'm Canadian. But that was then. And now I go and talk to students. This is a student actually that I was in her family who I spoke to in the recruitment process. And a lot of the students say to me, I know it's going to be tough for me to make American friends. Some of them accept it. Some of them are sort of strategizing and trying to be intentional. I had one student show me the list of colleges he was applying to, and I was like, what's guiding your college choices here? And he said, I looked up the number of Chinese students on these campuses, and these have very few Chinese students. Well, I have to make American friends. And, that's great that he made the initiative, but it's also a little heartbreaking as well. Why this matters, of course, is as Darla said, we can't just simply bring in a bunch of Chinese students, as if you add water and presto, internationalization. It doesn't work that way. Just not merely by coming into contact does not give our American students, who we all know are very unlikely to go abroad themselves, doesn't really give them that experience. And the Chinese students, like I said, they come in with greater awareness. And Sally and I were talking about this a moment ago when we were looking at some of Darla's slides, but we also talk about this as the challenge, the problem for Chinese students or with Chinese students. But isn't this in some ways the problem with our American students too? The Chinese students actually come in with a bit of an edge. Most of them now, if they're here on our campuses as undergraduates, have been preparing for this, have been planning for 4 or 5 years to come. And the Chinese students are, they're exposed to American culture, they see American movies, they watch Friends or whatever. And, it's not like Friends is going to give you a really super accurate portrait of what it's like to be a young adult in the United States. But it's a whole lot better than, what our American students are seeing. They're not watching the Chinese equivalent of Friends. I think a lot, frankly, of our American students come to campus and they're like, there's a bunch of students from China, these girls down the hall are from China. And that's the first time that they've ever given any thought to this. And so I think one of the big challenges is for American colleges to figure out ways to talk to their own domestic students, to prepare them for the students who are here on their campuses, who are their classmates. As I said, I think one of the issues is how much do we intervene, who does the intervention. I think a lot of times it's just put in international students' offices' lap. I think international students' offices can't see this one, sorry. We're getting much better at doing this, but when I first was on the beat, I was hearing from SIOs about how much they were struggling with these issues, and I soon came to realize, well, of course they're struggling, because they were just getting graduate students, so they would show up, and they would process their visas, and they would help them, you know, find a graduate student housing, maybe give them a list of schools to enroll their children in, and then they were fine. But these are 17 and 18-year-olds, and they need a lot more interventions. They require skills that are not about the sort of visa processing services that international, that used to be the bulk of international students' roles. That stuff is sort of typically the work of student services or student affairs offices. But those student services and student affairs offices were very much domestically oriented. They weren't really thinking about, when they were thinking about, say, how to deal with diversity and how to deal with that kind of acculturation issues, they were thinking about their domestic audiences, and they don't necessarily have the cultural competencies to deal with the Chinese kids. So how do you get the international offices who have the people with that kind of know-how working in concert with the student services offices? And then there's housing. You know, how do you bring them in? How do you bring you know, the people responsible for food? Because God, we all know that like there's nothing more important for homesick students than food. You know, it really gives you a sense of home. So how do you get all of these different players in a very siloed institution to work together, to collaborate? You know, I know Jean mentioned there's a task force here. I see that happening quite often on campuses, where really people are taking a step back and looking and saying, okay, what do we really have to do? How can we be thoughtful? How can we all work together to make this succeed? You know, I had the luxury, like I said, of going to a small campus where those kind of interactions could happen just merely by walking down. You know, that our Dean of International Students had, while it was a high percentage of students, he had maybe a couple hundred students. He knew everybody's name. He could walk down the hall and talk to the provost, and if he knew one of his students was having challenges in the classroom, and he could talk to, you know, the people in charge of like on-campus jobs if the student needed to get work. But it's really not that possible. It's really much more challenging for our institutions that tend to get the bulk of our Chinese students. And you know, if we're defining startups as success, what does success look like? I would say success is about having a positive experience. And I truly wonder, I mean, I kept in touch with the student I mentioned, the one who I was his only Canadian-American friend. And he did make friends after a while. He finally did. I mean, he was very aggressive about it. But he, you know, and very intentional. And he did. But he was also unusual. And, you know, how many students at a certain point are going to say, well, you know what, this just isn't working out for me, and I've got my Chinese friends and my support network, and I'm okay. But I worry that if that's what happens, or is that success? Are they coming away with a truly positive experience? Do they feel like they've had an American college experience? So that's the second part of the life cycle. The third part of the life cycle is what happens after graduation. You know, I mentioned I've been doing this job for almost a decade, and from the get-go, the question I got the most when I would talk with Chinese students and Chinese families was, what's going to happen after my student graduates? What's going to be the outcome for the students? I would sort of demur, and I would say, you know, we can't really say yet, because, you know, there's not enough students who've graduated. We don't really have much of a sample size. We do now. We've had, you know, a number of classes graduate and go off into the world. And I think what I have to say is, at first we were focused on recruitment. Now I think more of the emphasis has been on acculturation and giving our students the best possible experience on our campuses. I think what is going to have to happen next is thinking about what happens next for them when they leave us, because discipline because they're no longer our students doesn't mean, you know, they're our alumni. They're still part of our college family, so to speak. I know that Stony Brook does have somebody who specifically works in advising international students in the Career Services Office. That is not something I see on many campuses, unfortunately. And I think in the same way that I mentioned we're siloed for the services we provide students while they're on our campuses, bringing the people who have the career expertise together with the people who have the cultural knowledge is going to be pretty important. Two or three years ago, NAFSA, the Association for International Educators, did a survey. It was sort of a dual survey, actually. They asked educators and international administrators what they thought were the biggest sort of hiccups or challenges for their international students. And then they asked international students about their greatest sources of dissatisfaction. The international students' number one choice, lack of job and internship experience and support. It was not even on the educator's sort of list of the things that they were most concerned about. I was not surprised because I've been getting that question for years. And the reason is, certainly some of our international, certainly some of our parents rather send their students here because they, believe in the value of a liberal arts education. And they think that American higher education is the best, is the most highest quality in the world. But they are making a serious investment. They are spending, hundreds and thousands of dollars to send their children here, to prepare to send their children here. And they have very pragmatic reasons for wanting to do that. They want their children, usually their only child, to succeed. They want to secure them with a firm place in the world and give them all the best. They want to know that if they come back to China, where there's, the average college graduating class now is 7 million students, they want their child to stand out from those other 7 million applicants for jobs. Or they want their children to stay here in America, and they want them to have a life here. That's really challenging. Let me talk about the first one, the going back issue. First, because frankly, that's really what's going to happen to most of our students. The way visas work, we can talk about that later if you want, but most of them cannot stay here. They're going to have to go back and find jobs in China. And as I said, I think there hasn't been enough attention on our campuses about how to help these students look for jobs in China, not Chicago, kind of thing. I was talking with an advisor in a large business program, and a program that had a number of graduate programs that were specifically oriented towards international students, and particularly had large Chinese student enrollments. When I talked to him, this guy was just back from having visited for the very first time China. And these weren't new programs. They've been going on for 5 or 6 or 7 years. And he said, my mind was blown. He said, I realized that everything I've been telling my students is wrong. I've been preparing them, giving them mock interviews, helping them write their resumes, having them talk about their individual achievements and their qualities. And I realized, oh my God, they're going to this Confucian culture in which it's completely inappropriate to talk about yourself that way. You seem like a braggart and not a good team player. And he said, oh my God, I've got to totally think in a different fashion about this portion of my graduates and advising them. I talked, I did a story, actually, that was published a couple of months ago, focused very specifically on this issue, and I talked with a lot of people who have come into the space. It will not surprise you if you're familiar with China and sort of education, that there's now a business for helping students and employers make connections, Chinese students coming back from America and Chinese employers. And they said sometimes it's the littlest stuff that's tripping up students and their applications. For example, the paper size and the word processing programs are not necessarily the same. And it stands to reason, if you're dealing with 7 million graduates, a lot of this becomes mechanized. If your document doesn't scan properly, properly, your application gets thrown out. You never even get considered. And as I said, you know, I think the challenge is going to be, how do we get our colleges to sort of think about these problems on the big level, like how do you talk about yourself? And on the more micro level as well. When I did that story, some of the people I found that were best at thinking about this were folks who didn't have job descriptions that involved anything, that had anything to do with career services. They were people who, as a number of campuses have done, were in the China offices, so in Beijing or Shanghai, representing their university. They were often doing recruitment, or they were doing, facilitating international research partnerships or faculty research. But they were the representative of the university in these students' home country when they were returning. And so students were naturally gravitating towards them and looking for help in finding jobs. And I think to sort of carry our life, like the idea of the life cycle, in the same way that recruitment and the success and how one does recruitment affects how well the students are going to succeed on campus, in the very same way, thinking about this next step, the post-graduation step, and the success that students have in finding a job that's the right fit for them, whether in China or in America, also cycles back because it affects recruitment. Because if these pragmatic parents spend all this money, these students, studying in the United States, being apart from each other for 4 or 6 years, then they can't get a job. How well have you succeeded? And we haven't really talked about this one in international education, but it's surprising in a way because our American students think about this, about college, and our American families think about college in the same way. They talk about value added and career and return on investment. Let me just say a few words before I wrap up, because I know June wanted us to have time for conversation and questions if we wanted. So most of our students are going to go back, but some of them do want to stay. And when you talk with international students in general, not just Chinese students, they're very, very fluent in H-1B and OPT and STEM OPT. They really know the ins and outs of the visa system, the immigration system, very, very well. So they know that the odds are against them sort of being able to stay and work in the United States. They know this, yet I also talk with families, with parents, who believe, despite everything that they know, that their child is the unicorn. They will be the one kid who succeeds. And that's going to come to an end at a certain point when it becomes overwhelmingly evident that that they can't keep believing that. But the other thing I think that's happening that may speed that along, so to speak, is the conversation right now about the new administration and the travel ban. And I should say about the travel ban, of all the international students I talked to, the Chinese are the least concerned about the travel ban. When I talk certainly to Middle Eastern students or students from predominantly Muslim countries, they're very, very worried about the travel ban and, both the practical idea of will I both be able to come here and get a visa, and then once I get here, will I leave, or am I sort of stuck in the United States for the duration of my studies? And they're concerned about the notion of how welcoming it suggests America is. But Chinese students so far have been less concerned about that. What I do think that they share, though, with some of the other international students, is this idea of the sort of signaling effect that the travel ban has, that it sort of says both you might not be welcome here, and we might be thinking more about our immigration and visa policy under the new administration. And so I hear a lot of concern from students, from international students, including those from China, about whether or not it's going to become much, much more difficult to have an American work experience. Because even the students who don't think that they will stay or don't want to stay do often want to stay here for a time. Because one of the things that they think, and they're probably quite right, will get them, help them stand out from that crowd of many, many millions of applicants is having some critical work experience. And that's not something, unlike some of these other things I've suggested, that colleges have a lot of control over, but I think think it's worth us thinking about because it could have lasting impacts. I mean, when I think about this as a phenomenon, when I think about how, I really didn't know what I was getting myself into with this job years ago, and I've loved what I do, and it's my part because it's rare, I think, to feel like you're covering something that's really transformative. When President Trump and President Xi sat down last week in Mar-a-Lago, I think they probably didn't talk about higher education. I think it's too bad that they probably didn't, because I do think one of our most important exports to China is knowledge, is our degrees. And I think not only that, but maybe I'm being optimistic, but I think it can have really important lasting effects, because there's been nothing like this in the past. We've never had as many young people from the two most important, two most powerful countries in the world coming together and being in classrooms and being on campuses together. These are people who today are on our campuses, but tomorrow will be our educators, our business leaders, our political leaders. And what happens, not to give you guys any pressure, but I think what is happening on our campuses today really has the potential to be very, very meaningful, ongoing, to the relationship between our two countries. But it does require, I think, we can't just, as Darla said, it's not going to be just enough to have these two groups of students coexisting. We really have to think about how to make the best possible fit. So thanks very much.
We do have time for a couple of questions. Thank you again. So as a Chinese hearing Karen's talk, I felt, yes. So whatever we are doing, today she really hit the point far beyond recruitment. What is the end result? Why do parents invest so much for their children? If they do not get what they wish, if they cannot obtain their ultimate goal, will that slow down the application? Will that shift them to Karen's home country, Canada? Or will they move around? So I think that has a far reaching meaning for what we do. So the life cycle certainly brings us new perspective of what we are doing. And at Stony Brook University, we do have a career center. And that career center is working with Global Affairs Office, looking into the issues of international students. Given the current climate, what opportunities we can provide them while they're still students on campus. Even volunteer job will give them some experience. So I think that this is a very important issue. And I'm so glad that we have had two very powerful presentations this morning after break, where we will hear other perspectives. And what are other perspectives? Let's have coffee first. So come back at 11, where we will start a shop at 11. Thank you very much. Okay, so Michelle signaled me that we need a group focus. This is the time. Where? Okay, let's go outside. Before you have coffee, take a photo first. Okay, all right.